Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
I'd like to welcome everybody and wish everybody a happy Valentine's Day. It's nice of you to come in on Valentine's Day, and it's also a
share the love.
Share the love with everybody. I'm extremely honored to welcome Jason Salavon here. I've known Jason for, I don't know how long, we were trying to figure it out. I think it's more than 10. I know I've been a fan of his work for close to 20 years that he's been exhibiting it. He's had work in numerous galleries and museums around the world. And I got attracted to it at about the time that we started thinking about computational photography and what it meant to compute on images. I think you'll see from the talk that Jason has taken a very different idea. A while ago, we started to think about what it meant to take a whole packet of images and process them. And obviously, once you have a whole bunch of data, thinking of images as data, the obvious thing to do is to begin to average things. And I know this set here that he did was one of the first things that caught my eye. These are real estate listings that, through the magic of that Jason applied to them, gives you sort of the gist of the places. And the thing that pops out for all of us living in Seattle, it's pretty easy, even without the labels, to know which one of these is Seattle. We'll let you guess which one of these. We've lived here long enough to recognize those skies. Anyway, Jason, as I said, has exhibited in numerous places around the world. He has work that's shown in galleries around the world and museums around the world. Some of his work actually sits in permanent collections at the Metropolitan Museum in New York, at the Whitney in New York, Art Institute in Chicago, the LA County Museum, if you've ever been down there, and in the National Portrait Gallery. I didn't realize that one at the Smithsonian. Mm-hmm. Sort of curious what made it into there. And also, the Microsoft Art Collection contains, I think, at least three of his pieces. I don't know, when you're walking around the buildings, you'll should keep an eye out and see if you see them, and you'll know where they came from. Anyway, so it's a great honor to have Jason here to talk to us about his work a little bit.
Great.
Take it, Jason.
Thank you. So is there a way to lower the lights a little bit? Because it's going to be a very image-intensive... Lights. So thank you, Michael, for the introduction. It is really nice to be here. I'm escaping the polar vortex part 2.5 in Chicago right now, so I appreciate that as much as everything else. So I'm an artist, and I'm going to do a sort of my version of an artist talk, which kind of spans sampling, I don't know, maybe not 20 years, but probably like 15 years of work. And I'll sort of sample little bits of there, focus more on more recent work. But since we have a sort of a not a huge audience, I'm happy to sort of engage and be and answer questions and even go with digressions. So it's not, you know, we don't have to wait till Q&A at the end or anything. So it sounds like you guys are comfortable piping up, but please don't be shy about it. I think of myself as a computational artist, basically. I mean, I just usually call myself an artist, but my tools are writing software, using data, and I've been doing that since I was an undergraduate. I kind of made a conscious decision to start exploring art making through writing software. I do want to show one image, this image first, just to kind of frame the conversation a little bit. So this is a painting that hung above my bed when I was like 5 years old. And it was about that big. It was maybe a little bit smaller than that. And it's acrylic on panel, and it's a painting my dad made in the mid-70s. So that's the world I grew up in. He still makes work of all kinds. He's not a painter so much anymore, but I grew up around, at this point, he was making lots and lots of really interesting, weird paintings. And I grew up with that as like a normal fact of life. And I think it did have a lot of impact on where I went. One impact it had was I drew and painted a ton as a kid, but by the time I was in high school, I was zero interest in being an artist. I'd seen like a kind of like a lifelong, or at least I'd seen 10 years of sort of struggle. We were living in Fort Worth, Texas, and there's no way this has any market in Fort Worth, Texas in 1975. So, you know, there's just a lot of this stuff around the house, basically. And I loved it, and I was appreciative of it. I sensed the passion and all that, but did not set a good example for sort of, I could feel the struggle. That's what I'm sort of saying. And I had it gave me a different impression of what being an artist was that was maybe a little less romanticized. When I started undergrad at the University of Texas, I took a drawing class in my first semester just on a whim, and I just really fell in love with it. And being separated from having an environment that was my own, I really, really started sort of attacked sort of making art with a lot of vigor. But also I ended up being a CS minor, and I was taking sort of technical classes the whole time. And I was almost a major, but I didn't have enough hours. But that combination, you know, by my junior year, I was thinking, I think there's really interesting art to be made through writing software or through this sort of thing. And this is the early 90s and no support from faculty. I mean, I think faculty kind of begrudgingly went along with my weird ideas just to show just kind of some things I did in undergrad. It's not that useful, but this was like a 380-page sort of cotton paper book of tiled repeating forms I called Carpet Maker and dot matrix printer, 1991. In an apartment in Austin, and I just had this old. Now I'm a software operating system agnostic. I use all software operating systems. So whatever references you'll see works that are made in all different environments. But this piece was made on a little 9-inch Macintosh, and it's simple, but for me the magic of it was that I would write this little bit of code, press go to bed and wake up and have 30 new prints that held surprises, right? That I couldn't anticipate. Like I didn't anticipate that this form would happen. That sort of experience, the surprise of what kind of autonomous software processes can do, shaped sort of, you know, random processes that are sort of shaped, that surprise stays with me today. Like that's a really, combining data and having sort of slightly counterintuitive or even really counterintuitive results is still super important and meaningful to me. I ended up going to the School of the Art Institute of Chicago for graduate school. In like 94, they had an art and technology program, one of the few art schools, sort of formal high quality art schools that actually was sort of thinking, had a forward-thinking ideas about technology, the relationship between, like they had a strong robotics area, they had strong 3D graphics, I'd kind of made up my mind that it was the sort of the area I wanted to work in. This is a project that was part of my MFA thesis in 96 that's called The Grain Unification Theory, and this is, These are photographic prints, so a lot of times I make my prints through photography rather than printed in inkjet or another form. Partially that was because it was really the only way to make really good large-scale prints in the 90s. This is every frame of Star Wars, or every second of Star Wars, one frame per second, so 1/30th of Star Wars. And it's arranged not by order, but by luminosity, right? So it's not narrative that's driving this shape. And this was at a point when there wasn't a lot of, like, people were not working with cells of film there was not, that sort of stuff wasn't around. I had taken a job at, while in graduate school, I'd taken a job at Viacom New Media, which was Viacom's video game, soon to fail video game company. And I worked on like a Beavis and Butthead game, and I worked on a failed Snow Crash game, and your interactive pet dinosaur. And actually a team, one of the teams was basically folded into Bungie and ended up here. Anyway, the point of all that was I was using, at night, I was using Silicon Graphics machines to sort of capture and build these images. So there was nothing on at my school that could handle the amount of data. And we had a, do you guys remember Silicon Graphics? I think some of you guys do, yeah. We had an Onyx, with a four processor Onyx that was the size of a refrigerator that's less powerful than my phone. Maybe, something like that. Anyway, this is, so that's every second of Star Wars. This one's every second of Snow White. Yeah, so we can talk about fair use. Yeah, it's an interesting problem. This is every second of It's a Wonderful Life. And this is every second of Deep Throat. And you know, my interest in sort of performing these operations sort of almost clinically was some expectation of a kind of variability, a kind of variance between really different kinds of genre film, sort of archetypes of genre film, and the kinds of results. So like, you get this really, you know, beautiful gradient. The histogram is like really distributed, right? Versus, you know, this is a little bit of this, but mostly it's just inside two rooms, you know, the same lighting. And that combination of abstraction and sort of known recognizable content, I think is an important thing to me. I think it's an important thing in a kind of, if you're thinking about, Michael said something about stacks of photographs as data. That's completely how I think about it too. And if you think about like all of these frames as data, the choice of the content is really kind of key for me. It's really the specificity of these films is what makes or breaks a project like this. And at that moment, again, this was not, there was not, there weren't many people making sort of computational prints in this sort of, with this sort of feeling. And I was fortunate to start working with a gallery. Ended up leaving Viacom. I went to Midway and worked on the Blitz football games for Nintendo 64 and other things. I was an artist programmer, sort of hybrid, so I would work on the engine a little bit and then do modeling and talk to artists about, you know, kind of the specific needs of the engine. It was a cool job. I enjoyed working at Midway. But all the while, I'm continuing to make work, I'm having exhibitions, and so to talk a little bit more about this, the piece that Michael started with, for me it was kind of an intuitive switch to go, okay, I've got this grid of images and I'm sort of arranging by luminosity. It's not too big a stretch to start to think about those images, those fields of images in other ways. So kind of stacking averaged, you could take a mean or take a median was not too far from my thinking. But again, it's like the content for me is what kind of makes or breaks it. So they're all like homes in the median price range. They're all realtor photographs that have only, the only alteration would be that they're all cropped to the same size from center. There's no other alteration. And you know, the southern ones have sort of blue skies. LA Orange County even has a street because you've got like all these ranch houses, so the photographer always has to get far enough out to get the bit of street in here. New York and the five boroughs, you've got a more of a peaked roof, and you even have like gangways between buildings from the boroughs.
Another question.
Yeah.
Did you do anything in particular to achieve the sort of almost pastel-like feel of it?
I did no minor color adjustment for photography, not color adjustment. Yeah, that's all in the architecture. So one thing I found was, if you get over the low 100s with these sorts of really tight sets of, and it's funny because the way I speak to like an art audience is really different than the way I'm speaking to you guys. So I'm enjoying like an ability to speak in a slightly different language than I typically do. But these are really constrained sets of things. And if you put that number up past sort of 150, the thing goes to mush. And if you're under 75, you really can't make out distinct features. So I kind of found sort of naturally a kind of sweet spot where you have the kinds of little striations that are indicative of individual pieces of architecture, but they're not recognizable. It's hard to pull anything out. And that's really important too, right? I want to hit a kind of sweet spot of abstraction that still sort of hints at meaning and recognizability. I think if you went to 200, I think you'd still have the same kinds of palettes. The color palettes would sort of remain, but things would just get mushier and mushier.
So if you picked then 75 pictures out of 1,000, was there some curation about, oh, I want to get some of these, or was it just random?
It's random, and it's to the point where not in this project, but, and I've only done, I think people know me for these works. I'm strongly identified with these works, but I've probably only done 8 of these kinds of projects. But in later ones, I even would have assistants pick out images for me. I wanted to distance myself from that process to the degree that I would just describe, pick, you know, I'll skip around just to, in this project, which is commemorative photographs on the internet, I would tell an assistant, pick 100 photographs of a wedding couple with her on the left. I want 100 photographs of the little leaguer on one knee, you know. And I'd probably show him some archetypes and go, pick these guys, these are what we're looking for. But I just want the classic versions of these things. It's amazing how easy it was to find these things. I really am jumping around, but this might be interesting. So this is like one of them. It kind of starts to make a little bit of my point about what happens as you go through, you know, 5, you start to, what's interesting about these projects to me is, even with 5, you have the vector of where it's going is already fairly purely defined. Like it already tells you what it's going to be. And then as you shoot over that amount, it sort of just becomes more like the mushier and mushier version.
But you're cropping the faces.
What's that? This one has a little alignment. But that's it, and it's manual. It's not. I prefer as little of that kind of stuff as I can. There's something else that's happening here. Anyway, like in this project was one of the first ones. These are the high school graduation photographs of my mother and my high schools that are in the same, both in Fort Worth. In 1967 and 1988, and this required no alignment, no anything, right? You have the sort of standard size, so I want to lean on the photographer's definition of what the set is. Like that's kind of an important part of it. That I'm not seeking to make things happen. The set sort of really expresses itself. You know, you get a little anthropological things. Fort Worth was very conservative in 67, but some of the women are starting to get a little hippie here. You know, like things are starting to happen. I did a commission. I do commissions occasionally. I did a commission for a couple some years ago, and they were class of 1972. And they were in some like Springfield, Missouri or something. And by 72, both the man and woman have hair going past the shoulders, you know. And then by the time, you know, I'm in the Reagan era, you know, and it's full on preppy, you know. So although you can tell the demographics of the area have changed. Like I'm in a the school. We were in different high schools, but they were sort of similar. This is a really sort of complex demographic. Also, we still wear the same tux tops and the same sort of scooped, which I think is funny, 20 years later. The other thing I'm interested in like these kinds of things is how, for me, you know, I've been around these images a long time. These have really individual identities. Like this is a, this meta person has a real identity for me, which I think is spooky and weird. You know, I'm in there too with like 120 other high school seniors, but this is also he has a strong guy. I don't know if his name is Doug or what his name is, but he has that quality. I printed these in two sizes. One print size is this big, basically. So the sort of really massive, and then the 24 by 36 sort of wallet size version.
I love the kind of fuzziness, the pastel quality of these things, but have you ever experimented with trying to morph a bunch of images all together as well? So where you actually kind of eyes, ears, bottom chin, whatever.
Yeah, so some different projects that are, I think, distinct, but it'd be fun to talk about how they're similar. I'll show in a sec. The one thing I'll move on from the sort of average stuff, but maybe I'll show another one. But the one interesting point to me from a art history point of view, so lots of people say things like they look impressionistic. You guys are saying pastel. I think that's like synonymous. I think that usage is about impressionism and Turner and other kinds of. So painters at a certain point, especially when photography started, painters really started moving away from sort of accurately representing things to sort of abstracting things, right? So Monet painted this cathedral over and over again so he could sort of kind of take it from specificity, some kind of sort of attractive generic. And I wonder what it is about, I don't have an answer for this, but I keep wondering what it is about a kind of simple mathematical kind of relatively clinical process applied to some set of common images that starts to naturally hearken back to painters sort of exploring abstraction. What's the relationship between that kind of exploration and abstraction from an individual human versus a kind of, algorithmic, mechanized exploration of abstraction? And why is it that they look similar? What is it, is there something isomorphic or something related between the two processes? I don't have an answer, but I do think it's an interesting problem, interesting thing to consider, that these two kinds of abstraction do sort of look alike. Yeah. Yeah.
So there's a variance between like 100 to like 124. Are you curating the numbers to get to a final sort of composite that sort of feels right for you, or what's the difference?
I vacillate. It's weird because I'll do things in some project and I'll like completely contradict that thing in another project. I think at that moment, I thought it was boring to have them all be like exactly 110. I wanted just like kind of natural variety. I think, I was able to find more here. I liked it sort of that looseness of the sizes of the sets. I don't think I did much curation. I think I dumped images that were sort of so, we're in, I think we're in the 90s when I did these. At least I think I did three and I did three more. So we're right around 2000. And, people forget how crappy photography was on the internet in 2000, right? Like everything was 640x480 or smaller, it was, so I think I dumped super low quality stuff, but the guiding sort of vibe was basically a kind of looseness. I'm looking at them, I think I was also kind of bracketing them by population. Like, I don't think it's a coincidence that New York and LA have the two biggest numbers. Seattle has the small list. I think that's, I'm vaguely remembering that. But that's in contrast to the 100 Special Moments, which is called 100 Special Moments, Newlyweds, Kids with Santa, you know, where I wanted exactly 100 for each one. So, you know, and I had just gone a different way where then I wanted all these sets to be sort of identical and be, and use that sort of 100. You asked about morphing. I really am jumping around, but that's fine. There's a whole, more recently, the last 5 years, I occasionally do these projects that are essentially, this is an industrial monitor. So it's meant to sort of feel like a light box. And it's actually a 4-hour animation that's moving so slowly that it's literally outside of perception. The speed is, it's not trackable. But what it's doing, this is like the super sped up version. And it's the literal morph of mesh geometry. This is all rendered. And there's basically 4 biological key points. A baboon's, like a really, went to great expense to model a baboon skull, a human skull, a boar skull, and a bear skull. And then sort of, we even set up a rig so that you could put any proportion of the 4 skulls. They're topologically identical, so they can be morphed in any, you can just pull the and then it was this beautiful design project of just doing like, you know, how much, at this point in the animation, how much boar, how much whatever. And they're all, and mostly, they do hit each key point at some point, but they mostly you're in sort of fictional biological space. Which again, if I said that in an art talk, people would be like, what are you talking about? So you're in these sorts of, you're traversing. I think like, for me, a lot of my work is about dealing with sets as space and how to traverse or collapse or whatever, different kinds of sets. So this, you know, all these different frames, they could over, I actually did average a big chunk of these just to see what that looked like, you know, and it looked kind of like what you would expect. But so instead of sort of overlaying the set, I kind of generated it and I just did a walk through it, you know. But also, I'm really concerned with sort of traditional art issues. This is a still life, it's a classical Vanitas still life. It's sort of meant to look, feel like a Dutch still life. It's still, so lots of people are like, what? And they walk away and they come back 5 minutes later. Or maybe they get their mind a little blown by the fact that it's something different. I think people like to have these around because they can, they live with them and they're surprised by them. But so I think for me, it's like that kind of piece is a similar approach to these pieces. So while we're talking about Old Masters, this is the last one. So I'm not sure I'm gonna do any more of these sorts of basic averaging pieces, but this feels like the last one. Never say never, but. And this is entire portrait oeuvres. So in this case, I sought to find every Franz Hals portrait I could find, right? So this is all the Franz Hals portraits. And these are all painters painting around the same, within 50 years. Van Dyck, who's the only artist who's of the time who's sort of doing 3-quarter portraits, but it's all, like half of his portraits are Prince Edward, and he always wants to show off his fancy clothes. This is Velázquez. And then this is Rembrandt. Rembrandt really distinct in his use of black and the sort of punching the glow. So I think of my work as sort of having some branches, tendrils. One of the branches that have been with me for a long time, this is another early 2000s work, is clinical graphs of data whose intentions aren't necessarily about teaching. So this one, and that becomes kind of complicated. So this is shoe production in the US. This is all one 3-dimensional graph of shoe production in the US from the 60s to the late 90s, I guess. And they're 4 photographic prints. They're again printed photographically. They're 4x4 foot. So I also did like there's a video that goes with them. It's just a little fly through of the data set. And this was all sort of scripted in, at the time it was, this is rendered in Maya, so it's using Maya's scripting language, which is now Python, but at the time they had their own scripting language. The thing I was interested in is I want to take a banal data set, something that I think of as just having kind of no kind of affect, like shoe production was what I was, for whatever reason I was thinking of, take all the sort of census data and try to make it like a psychedelic, right? Like I wanted it to be, I didn't want it to learn about shoe production. I wanted to learn about squeezing data into different kinds of shapes and forms clinically, right? So it is, if you have a key, it's readable. This is actually the past. This is the present. So this is, the timeline is sort of a vertical. Distance from center is basically number of shoes produced. And there's 31 categories. So there's like women's heels and children's play and men's work and all these different, you know, census tracks all of these different categories of shoe production. So the weird, interesting thing to me that came out of it, well, a couple things, like many people, especially the ladies, told me that shoes are not banal or mundane. And I get that a lot. I'm like, got it, point taken. So maybe it's not a mundane data set. But the other thing is that the shape is sort of a, like a volcano-y sort of, this is the peak of it, and the base is down here. That shape, that strong peak, is because we don't make shoes in the US anymore. So that big wide base is us making shoes in the 60s, and this is us not making shoes anymore, which I had zero, I did not predict that at all, did not expect that at all. And it was a weird lesson in a kind of relationship between data where if the data is telling a story, and you're sort of consistent about the way you treat it, no matter how you treat it, like this, you could think of, I guess, an infinite number of ways of trying to graph that particular data set. Some kind of strong sort of slope will show up, and that slope will demonstrate the sort of outsourcing of shoe production. And I was thinking I wanted to make this really, I wouldn't say cynical, but I was making a piece that was about sort of twisting of data for visual effect. And then I still got a kind of socio-political thing happening without even intending it, and it's got me to thinking about data. So historically, artists paint trees, and you know, not so much the second half of the 20th century, but historically before that, especially in Western art, you find these sort of formal things. People, trees, mountains, beautiful, different kinds of things, still lifes. And you explore that form over and over again, right? So you have the history of the still life all the way to today as an experiment in sort of different kinds of representation of a form. My feeling about data, which is like, what is data? Data is really just sort of numerical sort of assignment of things happening in the real world, right? Like at some point there's something, they're grounded to reality, that these data sets are formal entities, right? They are, in some, I wouldn't call them real, but in some sense, they're like the tree and representing the tree. That's, I guess, what I'm trying to say. Like, I'm really interested artistically in thinking about data sets as these sort of fungible things that still have a kind of form that always has to be sort of negotiated with and dealt with. And I'll kind of just follow that up with talking about this piece. So this is a piece that was installed recently. This is a 40-foot light box in the lobby of the US Census Bureau headquarters. And this image is the U.S. population, similar to the shoes piece, that the U.S. population from 1790 to the present in these sorts of sheets. More recently, we installed this thing which uses Microsoft Touch, which I enjoyed working with a lot, actually, which is a kind of haptic interface to the data set itself. But I want to talk a little bit about how the data was, how I sort of made this image, right? This pure abstraction. Putting a large sort of data viz in the Census Bureau, I knew, and I'd had lots of meetings with their social scientists and their statisticians, and was really impressed by their real deep comfort with and awareness of their data. And I thought, presumptuous to try to teach them something about their data. So my interest was in exploring that fungible aesthetic quality of data. But I also want to show how it's built, and that this little bit's in the interface. So this is the population of Cook County, where I'm from, in the past, now, so we sort of leveled out. This is the 60s. These are all 3,171 U.S. counties. So lots of small counties, just making it black. Now color-coded by the state they belong to. And we sort of build the form. So I basically sort of built this three-dimensional form and then acted as a photographer and picked out a view that I was really interested in for the static version. The whole thing is really meant as a dynamic piece. That's why the touchscreen piece is so important. But, you know, it's literally like a series of transformations to build a thing. I really like working in 3D with data, but in an abstract way, because you have this freedom to sort of build sculptures, essentially, out of, you know, this is the births and deaths of people and the movement of people around the country, right? And that sort of transferred into this abstraction is really interesting to me. So I'll just talk about a couple more pieces that explore similar ideas from different perspectives, maybe. These are little photo pieces. I hadn't done these sort of cell photo pieces since the movie piece thing, and I'd come back to it a little bit. I don't know, not sure how long I'll do it, but this is called Good and Evil 12, so it's just a year and a half old. It leans on, I know people here are working on some of this a little bit, so I was really interested in that. A paper that Peter Dodds, who's at Vermont, wrote three years ago, where he had Amazon Turk, hired people through Amazon Turk to rank the 10,000 most frequently used words in the English language by positivity. That's the only sort of attribute. So the most positive word to the most negative word in the top list. And this is that list. So laughter is the highest ranked in positivity. Terrorist right now is the lowest ranked of popularly used words. And then I did do Bing searches, Bing image searches for all of these words. I use Bing because you guys, or not you guys, but this company is much more generous than Google is with its image usage. Like, you can use a lot more before you have to start paying for it. The API allows you a lot more freedom. Google starts charging you a fair amount much quicker. Anyway, these were arranged. Each of these panels is essentially a pie chart. Like, these little rays are the image searches for each of those words in order. So starting with laughter, I think, at this point. So you can see that here. So this is the good panel, and this is the evil panel. Yeah, it's darker, it's less saturated. I was actually anticipating, this is like these fun surprises, I was anticipating it actually being more starkly different. In person, they're really noticeable. But the other thing I did was, these little monitors play, there's 25,000 images. And these monitors play all of the 25,000. So they'll show the word that it's mapped to, and it'll just sort of go through it. And of course, I had Safe Search turned off. And this little screen, which shows the evil panel, shows some of the most distasteful, tough imagery that I can imagine. And I've never, you've seen, I'm not shy about exploring certain kinds of things like the Playboy pieces or other things I haven't talked about. But we had to actually post a parental warning. And what's interesting is I just wrote software to grab images based on words like cancer and based on whatever. I had Safe Search turned off, but I'm really interested in that kind of amoral quality of like search, right? So, hey, the algorithm returned. I mean, there's really, you know, there's an image of like someone defecating in someone else's mouth while they're being like, you know, bound in bondage, right? And it's just over the top. It's really interesting. In a conceptual way, it's pretty difficult. They go by real fast, but it was really important to me actually to sort of that quality that, you know, this, and then this is obviously like kind of conforms to expectation. It's like puppies and ice cream and sunshine. So that quality of what search does with our requests is echoed here. It's the last piece I'll talk about. This is done at the same time, basically. It's a Roy G. Biv color wheel, and I noticed that downstairs, the artist who was here did a little bit of stuff with color as well and search. This is the Roy G. Biv color wheel in tertiary colors. So you've got your standard Roy G. Biv, and then you have the tertiary colors, which are, you know, red, orange, et cetera, et cetera. So it kind of conforms to expectation, except for this chunk here is for blue-violet, and Violet Blue is an adult actress. And changes that little wedge into just flesh tone, right? Because whenever anybody searches for blue-violet, I guess they are always searching for this actress, not for the color blue-violet. So again, you get this, and you know, I'm really interested in those accidents and mistakes, you know, or are they mistakes, right? Like, I don't know if they're mistakes, but that semantic sort of confusion between myself and software. So, you know, I was super excited by that result, to be honest. That was, that I think made the piece for me. So there's more work here, but I'm happy to sort of answer some questions generally, or I think we're at a good spot. I appreciate you guys coming. Thank you.
Do you have a little bit of a video of the touch interaction on the census
piece? I don't have it edited. I have it. You know, I have some old, there's something old on, maybe on here. Nope. No. Try one more time. Yeah, I would really like to have that ready for you guys, but I'm pleased with the way it turned out, and apparently the census people are really happy with it. So I think we had fun, and that was new to me. That project was new. I had some experienced programmers on the team it was a year long project. It was a really fun one. Yeah.
So on that piece, it seems, just looking at it, it looks great. I mean, it's great, like wall art. But how much does it play into your thinking that it's hard to interpret? Like, if you told me what it, you explained to us what it was.
Yeah.
But now, even though I know what it is, if I looked at that perspective, I looked at that, I can't glean much information.
I don't know what this is doing. That's why this thing is essential. You know, I have a lot of mixed feelings about my software. I have a lot of mixed feelings about how much to reveal. You know, it's a question I have. But in that particular piece, for that audience, like a lot of this depends on who it is you're communicating with. So it's people who live with the piece, who live in the building, who work on various, you know, it's 6,000 employees at the Census Bureau. It's a big organization. I was really happy with the aesthetics of that object, and I'm also, but I'm more interested in the kinds of the story that yielded that object. So you literally, like, there are dials where you can literally unfold and refold it. Like, you can go from the graph. There's a graph mode where you can select individual counties and then switch from that county into the graph mode. There's all kinds of different ways that I'm explicitly showing how the form was generated. So, and it was a really important problem for me to solve, like, in that case. Now, in other cases, I've done pieces where I can tell someone walked off without, you know, I didn't talk about, I don't know if this is going to work now, but the Titanic piece. I've never had this thing break down, and of course it would happen here.
What software is that?
It's a website, but I use this old, it's actually a really old browser the full screen works really well. But it's a local website, basically. So, like, a piece like this, which I usually talk about and I haven't yet, it's called the top grossing film of all time, one by one. So it's a print that's this big, if not a little bit bigger. It's a really large photographic print. And each of these little sort of specks, you can see they're squares, are actually one frame from the film Titanic, taking the mean across the entire image to a solid color, right? So it's the average color for the frame. Yeah, right, right. Yeah, no longer the top grossing film, it's true. This is the ship going down. This is bad times. This is I'm King of the World up here. That's them, like, running through the ship with, like, there's all this electrical popping. Like, they're in the bowels of the ship, and there's a lot of, they're like loose wires, and there's all this sort of electrical popping. And it's literally, like, some of it's per frame. But, you know, the film is called the top grossing film of all time. I mean, the piece is called the top grossing film of all time, one by one. But for years, I've seen people walk up to it, look at it, walk away, not know what the piece was. You know, I don't know what to do. I mean, it is part of the identity of these things that sometimes there's more backstory and the thing is truly what it purports to be, but how to communicate that, or should I? Like, maybe, you know, the identity of this thing is okay as it is. You know, it's a kind of an open question. This piece was in a Whitney exhibition, and so DiCaprio ended up buying one. All kinds of cool stuff happened, but the weirdest part of it, and this is early 2000s, a big Hollywood production studio wanted to license the software to use on dailies. Like, they're gonna run it on things. And it was interesting and flattering, and it was the first realization that that this work I was doing had an interest to sort of commerce and other like, it had a, there were people who wanted to try to apply these things. I meant this as purely as an artistic sort of exploration, and, you know, that Hollywood would, it fell through and it didn't happen, but that Hollywood's like, oh, we want to do that on our movies. I always thought it was hilarious, because I was like, what does that mean? They're gonna just, we need to add more red here. Like, I always wondered what they would do with that information. Got to go back and reshoot some purple scenes. But it was kind of a moment where I realized, oh, the place I'm operating has this strong interest in lots of fields. And now we are, you know, 12 years later, 13 years later, and it's just this sort of idea of data, visualization of big data is sort of this ubiquitous thing. And, you know, my 12-year-old niece knows what data viz is, and my grandmother knows what, you know, data viz is, right? Yeah.
So one thing I didn't mention about Jason is he teaches at the University of Chicago, actually just got tenure there. So I was wondering kind of what you teach, and do your students have a tendency to produce pieces that look like, you know, yeah, Savant pieces, and how do you kind of get around that, or is that good or bad?
I have a a dual appointment at the University of Chicago in the Computation Institute, which is like a research entity that's partnered with, it's part of Argonne Labs, so it's high performance computing oriented. And I think of myself as one of the token sort of humanists there, but have done some interesting collaborations with other faculty in the kind of universe of data viz and other things. And then my teaching appointment is in the art department. So I teach computation for art types of classes. So imaging classes that integrate sort of programming ideas. I built out a University of Chicago had no, it's a very theoretical university and had no, no makerspace of any kind. So I built out a makerspace and I'm teaching some classes in there. I never show my work to my classes. They find it, but and I can tell, but I sometimes you see stuff that's like, oh, I know where you got that idea. But I show a lot of artwork. There's lots of, to me, lots of different, you know, we're in a really nice moment for the collision of art and computation. Like it's finally here. Like we have bandwidth and we have power and we have, you know, relatively inexpensive machines where a small team or individual can put together really amazing things. And that's really gratifying. So there's lots of stuff to show. But I am interested in, like, I'll teach some sort of basic stuff, like Photoshop-y stuff, but I'm always trying to push them toward process, algorithm. We were talking about processing. I love showing, teaching kids processing. It's a really, like, low barrier entry into software. It's tons of interesting examples for them to sort of kick the wheels on. And then I advise graduate students who, my background, I think, helps with this. I advise painters and, you know, I'm interested in art kind of writ large, even if my own practice is really rooted in computation and in sort of reorganization of information, maybe. So, yeah.
Are students mostly art students or are they computer
science? My students are art students. I work with a lot of CS undergrads in my classes. So I find myself teaching these classes that are like literally half physics and CS students and half art students, which is super fun. And I'll like curate teams to do sort of installations, and that's been really gratifying. And you know, there's the undergrads there are generally speaking really good and really like up for challenges and up to sort of stretch themselves in different directions from both sides of that aisle, I guess. But yeah, my graduate students are art students. Although there's talk about me advising some sort of PhD students too.
For your students, like from art to programming, then from programming to art, like how hard is it to teach them, you know, like programmers, how do you like teach them like color theory, blah, 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 and artists like, oh, algorithms, for loops, like how what's your...
yeah, those are both experience? Hard. My mechanism tends to be through example. So show lots of stuff, like turn them on to things that I think are interesting combinations of these things and stretch their minds sort of visually first, like sort of show them the space of possibilities and then start to talk about principles and things like that. That especially, both directions that works for. There are other people who teach sort of more fundamental things like color theory and stuff like that. I do talk a lot about composition and those sorts of things. Most of my classes are real maker oriented, like you're making stuff, they're studio classes. So we do a lot of critique, which is sort of, you know, everybody making stuff, putting it up and talking about it.
How do you grade them?
Roughly. I'm not too hard on them. Art grading has always been a complicated thing. I try to establish some criteria that are sort of standardized, but effort means a lot. Art is a thing where I believe there's something about innate talent that's involved. So, you know, if somebody really tries really hard, there's a lot of credit for that in my mind. And you know, UFC kids they're great. I love them, but complaining about an A- is the most annoying thing in the world. Oh God.
One more question for that.
Yeah.
Do you For students who come from, you know, from a, or like, or other people that come from a science background, do you see like a kind of obstacle for them to pass like a form, you know, they like this algorithm, you know, this function, what it means, you know, so they have more of an inhibition to use it for art by, you know, being like in the specifics of the algorithm rather than the art it produces. It's a different kind of approach.
Yeah, it is a different approach. Like in my own work, I tend to be a whatever works kind of guy. I tend to be interested in the phenomena that you're going to experience and the black boxes that one puts together to get there. While I'm interested in them, I am interested, like, I've talked to a bunch of people yesterday, I'm interested in nitty gritty, but I don't privilege it over getting the job done. I do try to put that across for art making, that when a person comes up to a thing you've made, most of the time they don't give a shit about like all the little details of its construction, right? That's something you have joy of in your own world. And I mean, it's the same with software design, right? Like nobody cares what's under the hood if it works as a user, but that doesn't take away from the joy of it. Like I said something about being interested in the final product. I actually love programming. I love working on problems. I really like disappear for 12 hours. I'm like, where did the time go? I've been like beaten on this problem. That joy is a personal kind of joy that's about generating these things, but I'm not expecting my audience to sort of get in there and have that joy with me. Like that's a thing I do that's somewhat separate from their experience of it. So anyway, I try to relay those kinds of ideas. And again, the thing I found that works the best is show them lots of cool stuff and get their mind thinking, oh, and then they can problem solve their specific thing. I mean, what is great about like undergrads, you know, they've never touched an Arduino and they're making robots in like 36 hours, right? So that's like a super joy from working with sort of tech and science oriented kids is they go and take care of all that by themselves. I don't have to do much, you know. So then I'm more about ideas and what is it they're going to make and that sort of thing. And then from the art side, then I have to do a lot more sort of hand-holding about, you know, loops and conditionals and, you know, just sort of like basic stuff. But putting them in teams, they help each other a lot too. So that's been really gratifying. I've enjoyed, there's a particular class that I'm really pushing that direction. It's been my most enjoyable class to teach lately.
Thanks a lot, Jason.
Thank you guys for coming. Appreciate it.